Hello and welcome to this tutorial series, Complex Wire Removal with Silhouette and Mocha Pro, with me, Ben Brownlee. And here's the shot we're going to be looking at. And you'll see, this is not the most straightforward wire removal. And here's around whereabouts we're going to end up. So let's get started and have a look at the strategies I've used to tackle this shot. All right, I'm in Silhouette at the moment, and let's take a quick look at the node tree that I've used so far. And this looks a little bit sort of spaghetti-ish because I've made sure that all the nodes are visible. When we make this ourselves, I'll also be showing you how to group these properly and make this look a little bit neater. But suffice to say, this is the main footage that we are starting with. And there are a few different techniques that I've used to try to get us to the final result. Now, I've color coded some of these nodes, so it's going to be a bit easier for you to see that. But I've used a lot of Mocha Pro data, which we can see. Actually, most of these are being X'd out because I'm not using those actively in the comp. But these are the ones in light green. We've used paint a few times. These are the ones in dark blue. And we go down and find a little bit more paint as well. There are several roto nodes that I'm using to isolate different areas out. And I've got a couple of different trackers and transforms in here that are helping me to match move elements together. So really what I'm hoping you get out of this view is that I'm using similar techniques all the way through, or similar types of nodes all the way through to help to build up this shot. So let's start with the basic shot and look at it from the very beginning. And let's just take a look at the media. So this is actually the most important stage of any type of tricky shot, whether it's roto, cleanup, or, you know, in this case, wire removal. The most important thing is to analyze the shot, try and see what the problems are going to be, predict any issues that we have, and then work our way through fixing it. All right, so we have a few things that look fairly straightforward. So let's take a little look here. Now, where the wires are free from the body, up at the top here, we have a fairly static looking background. This is great. So that means that the wire remove for the top here is going to be fairly straightforward. Unfortunately, that's only a small fraction of what we have. So now we have the complex bits, and that's the parts where the wires are going across areas that we actually want to keep in. So it goes across the face here. That's not great. And we have it across the body, which is not too bad, except for the fact that the body is turning. And as the body turns, look what happens to that wire on the right hand side. Yet we have nice flowing hair going over it. Okay, interesting. And over on the left hand side, we have a similar thing. So we have hair going up and over, and also the wire not just crossing the body, but as the body spins around, we're seeing different areas of that as well. So that's quite tough. Now, what you might spot as well is we have a few frames that are more heavily compressed than others. So this could be a bit of an issue as well. So we see the start frame there, we can see the outline there, that's not looking great, and then it goes sharp again. We get another one just over here as well. Well, this means we have some things that we can control for, and some things that are going to be out of our control. It also means that we have some areas of this wire removed that are going to be fairly easy to handle, and some areas that are going to be rather horrible. So what strategies am I going to use here? Well, it's going to break down to three main ones, actually. Patch, power mesh, paint, the three P's. Basically put, where the wires are completely free of the body, we can easily patch those in. So we can create a steel plate and then match move that in. Where we have things that are crossing the body, We're going to be using PowerMesh to match that sort of motion wherever we can. And where we can't do that, where things are, you know, just far, far too complex, we're going to be doing manual paint, frame by frame paint. Now, with that in mind, what is the most important thing that we want to do? Now, with all of these types of shots, in fact, with any paint shot, the most important thing, and actually the trickiest thing to do, is to keep temporal cohesion. So that means when we're playing stuff back, is that each frame looks like it's part of a moving image. So it's very easy to do this sort of paint work on a still image where we don't have to pay attention to everything else that's going on around it. It is very difficult to make this look absolutely right across multiple frames. And that's the big reason why frame by frame painting is hard, and why the artists that do this, you know, all the time are very good at it. And this brings us into a question which we're going to come back to again. Why not just try to patch it all in? Well, let's zoom in. I'm gonna show you this here. One of the big reasons for not being able to patch it in all the time with still frames is because as we move around, the lighting is going to change up quite a bit. So shadows and the way that the sun hits the skin is going to change up. So if we put in just still frame patches across everything, we're going to be able to spot that quite easily. So shadows, color changes, all of that sort of stuff is going to make things rather tricky for us. And at every point in this situation, we want to make things as easy as they can be, because this is quite a tricky shot. So the worst thing for us to try to do is to try to tackle this as a single area, like one big shot. It's not, we can't think of it like that. We need to think of it, break it down as a number of smaller problems that we need to face. So now we've identified the problems, let's start to tackle them. And I'm going to go in order of what should be the most straightforward and then work our way up to the more tricky ones. Right, so let's bring this into a new session, and I'm going to call this one Wire Remove 01. You can see it's Ultra HD, so 3840 by 2160. I'm going to use the composite template with the composite workspace. Actually, let's use the streamlined workspace so we can see that a little bit easier. And we'll bring in the whole clip, 102 frames. And I'll just work on 8-bit for this to use our RAM most efficiently. All right. So what is the first thing that we're going to do? Well, actually, I've already done the first thing that we need to do. If we take a quick look at what our file is called, it's actually called Wire Denoise. So the first thing that I always do when I'm doing this sort of paint work is to denoise the clip. And there's a good reason for that. This is the original, and I'll show you. I've got a frame from my original, which is frame 128. So let's see if I can find that same frame. So just double clicking between the two here. And they look pretty similar, yeah? Well, let's actually zoom in on the viewer so we can see the difference. Let's pan around, holding down the space bar. And I'm going to just go into my color channels. Probably we'll start with blue because that's, you know, generally the most noisy here. So this is my denoised, and this is my original, and you can see the difference. Now, the reason that I want to paint on a denoised clip is because when I'm painting up this stuff, I'll be using things like drag and clone. And that will have an effect on how the image looks with noise as well. So painting on grain, or painting on a clip that already has a lot of grain on it, or a lot of noise in it, runs the risk of creating telltale patches where we can see that the grain quality, the sort of the nature of the grain in the images that we're painting up and changing, looks different than the original source. Even if I come into the red here, which is where most of the skin is, So you can see the denoise and the noise is such a huge difference here that just trying to do wire remove on a big noisy image is going to make a lot more work for ourselves. So we're going to degrain the clip, and then at the end we're going to add that grain back. Now there's a number of different ways that we can do this degraining. Let's come back over here. We do have grain management tools directly within Silhouette. So we have like a degrain in here, so that can help to sort of remove some of the lighter grain. But this is quite deep grain, so it goes probably beyond where we want to go with just the regular degrain. And it's for that reason that within Silhouette we can use different OFX tools as well. So if we look in the BCC image restoration, we actually have like noise reduction tools, or you can get other third party noise reduction tools to help out here as well. So it's then just a case of coming in and degraining this stuff up. Now the more specialized noise reduction tools obviously look at different frames. They need different frames to help to analyze and remove the noise. So if I'm just trying to do temporal smoothing on this still image, it's not going to work. So that's why nothing much is happening here. But the point stands, degrain before we start doing any other work. Okay. In this initial exercise, we began our analysis of the shot and the overall strategies we'll be using to tackle this wire remove by using the three P's: patch, power mesh, and paint. And finally, the importance of grain management if we're going to be painting up a shot. Coming up in part two, we'll be removing the top wires with the help of Mocha Pro and generate up a clean plate using mega plates. So I'll see you in the next exercise.